What's up, guys? Welcome to my channel and thank you so much for choosing me today. Today, I'm going to be doing another true crime case. I'm trying to keep true crime on a Tuesday as opposed to uploading the random shorts that I usually upload, but we'll see how that goes. I wanted to cover another serial killer case. I have covered two cases before. I will link them in the description below and you can check them out. What I find interesting is the fact that serial killers turn out to be the most unlikely people. It could be the quiet John, the polite quiet John in the corner of the room minding his own business, or it could be the life of the party John who loves people and interacts with everyone. They keep killing, you know what I mean? And literally the only thing that stops a serial killer from killing is jail. Like, does that not... Like, isn't that crazy that the only reason that any serial killer has stopped killing is because they've died or because they're in jail? Otherwise, they just keep doing it. It's like an addiction to them. But this next case that I am going to cover and go through is very different in a sense that usually when you study a serial killer's life or, you know, watch documentaries, read articles, usually you will find in that particular serial killer's life that there were droplets and hints of abnormal behavior. The most common one being that they start killing animals and finding pleasure in killing like pets. So you always find those little clues, and then when they turn out to be a serial killer, it kind of makes sense why, because of certain adversities and certain rejections that they've had in their lives that led them to now committing multiple murders. In this case, there are no hints, there are no droplets of abnormalities. This case is going to take us to Durban, so if you're a Durbanite, you will definitely recognize the places that are mentioned in this case. You're probably not too far away from those places, so buckle up. But anyway, without rambling on too much, let's get into this case. On the 20th of March 2011 would be the start or the beginning of the bloodiest killing spree. All victims targeted were males who were randomly selected, not posing any threat to the perpetrator, having no relation whatsoever to the perpetrator. They would be chased down and killed at ungodly hours, specifically at very early hours of the morning. Witnesses would describe the killer as a huge, scary man. And we would all come to learn that the scary, huge man was named Joseph Njongwana. Joseph would be seen driving a silver car, which that silver car ended up being the very thing that led authorities to his home in Yellowwood Park, Durban. So who is Joseph Njongwana? Joseph was actually a former Blue Bulls rugby player. Also played for the Southwestern District Eagles. And like I said in the beginning of this video, absolutely nothing in Joseph's life would have predicted that he would turn out to someday go on a killing spree. And to this day, nobody actually knows why Joseph snapped in such a deadly way. Now for Joseph, rugby ran in the family. His dad was actually a rugby veteran by the name of Liston Njongwana. Joseph's dad was also the first black Springbok coach. Joseph's dad, Liston, also played for the African Springboks, which is South Africa's national rugby team. Joseph was described to be a gentle giant by his peers, and he was also described to be the joker in the dressing room. He grew up in Mthatha, and he would attend private schools, and their family was also middle upper class. Joseph had a loving family. He had a great relationship with his parents. Now let's rewind 20th of March 2011. This would be the first day that he sought out his first victim, Thembelinkosi Cebekhulu. Joseph sought after Thembelinkosi in Montclair. Joseph followed him. Thembelinkosi was killed in a South Durban suburb. The very next day, on the 21st of March 2011, he attacked a man in Umlazi. But luckily for this man, he managed to escape Joseph's wrath. Very next day, again on the 22nd of March 2011, Joseph targeted a man by the name of Paulos Hlongwa. Joseph attacked and killed Paulos in Lamontville, and Paulos would be his first victim that he had fully decapitated. His head was found in a nearby bin, a few meters away from his body. 2 days later, on the 24th of March 2011, Joseph targeted Simon Ngidi. He hacked Simon to death in Umbilo at 3 a.m. However, Joseph was interrupted by a witness who happened to be a student. I believe the witness was studying. So he happened to see like two men running and he thought, oh, you know, it's people playing around, only to find that he was actually witnessing a murder. Now, for this witness, he was brave enough to yell at Joseph to stop what he was doing, to let the man go, which Joseph was interrupted by that and heard him and decided to run away. But unfortunately, Simon was already dead. And then within that week after Simon Ngidi's death, Joseph attacked another unnamed victim. During his killing spree, Joseph had decapitated two victims' heads. Now, none of these victims posed any threat to Joseph. None of them had any relation to him. They were all randomly selected. He made sure that he targeted males specifically who were alone, usually at the very early hours of the morning. And witnesses confirmed that Joseph would ride around in a silver car. He managed to get his number plates, which would be the very thing that led authorities to Joseph's home, where his home was raided. Now, upon all these murders and upon Joseph's arrest, we would later learn that Joseph was actually involved in other crimes committed 4 months before his killing spree, which started on the 20th of March 2011. It turns out that 4 months earlier, Joseph had kidnapped a woman and kept her in his home in Yellowwood Park for 3 days, where he would rape her multiple times. Now, according to this witness, she also confirmed that Joseph was insane. She was accused by Joseph of being unfaithful, except she was not Joseph's girlfriend. Joseph would have her lick yogurt off of his body. He accused this woman of giving his daughter HIV/AIDS, except Joseph did not have a daughter. She was raped repeatedly. She was kidnapped and kept hostage at Joseph's home for 3 days. Thankfully, she didn't lose her life. When I read about that testimony, I could tell before reading other articles that could confirm that there's obviously a mental health issue here. There's some sort of imbalance. Like, things are not making sense, and this man acting like a crazy person. Joseph's lawyers had taken advantage of his bizarre behavior, and their whole argument, their entire strategy was based around the fact that Joseph was mentally ill and mentally unstable. The defense argued that he cannot be held responsible for the murders because he did not know what he was doing and he was not aware of what he was doing. His family also confirmed his mental health issues, and they also felt that he should not have had a harsh sentence because he did not know what he was doing. So how can he be accountable for it?
The Nchongwane family was clearly upset.
We respect the judge's ruling, but we do not agree with it. We do not agree with it solely because my brother's mental condition has not been taken into consideration.
Also, according to his family, Joseph was not taking his medication. And there's another article. I will link all the articles that I went through in the description box below. But his mom had said that he would forget. His mom recalled a story where she was visiting Joseph while he was kept in prison, I guess while his trial was going on, and she came with their lawyer, or Joseph's lawyer. And when his mom approached him to visit him with the lawyer, Joseph got so upset and he demanded that the lawyer be taken away. And why did his mom come with the lawyer? Then the very next day, the mom visited him again and did not bring their lawyer this time. And then Joseph had an opposite reaction to the previous day. So when his mom came without the lawyer, Joseph was like, "Where is the lawyer?" And the mom said, "You acted crazily yesterday and said that you didn't want your lawyer here, so I decided to come without him." Now, this is also why Joseph did not testify in court, because he conveniently had memory loss. He did not recall anything. He did not recall any murders, so therefore he was not fit to testify in court. According to him, he did not remember anything. Again, his family said he was not taking his medication, and his mom, you know, blamed the doctors and said that she had told them that he's not well, they need to look into him more. They need to do this, they need to do that. But my thing is, a doctor can only do so much. If you take someone to the doctor for whatever reason, they can treat the patient there and then, and they can offer you medications to help you through that illness or whatever the case is. But if that patient goes home and does not take their medication, you can't blame doctors for that. You can't, like, there's only so much a doctor can do. Also, just because you have mental illness does not mean you have to go out killing people. Now, Joseph had his own team of doctors, or should I say a psychiatrist or psychologist, and of course, that psychologist had confirmed as well that Joseph was seriously ill. However, despite all of what I've just told you about his mental illness, the judge completely tossed that entire argument out the window. And the judge felt that the way Joseph murdered, the way he executed these murders, says a lot about the fact that he knew what he was doing. And I will touch on this point a little bit later in the video. We'll get back and I'll elaborate on this point a little bit later. Now, during his trial, Joseph did not appear remorseful. Instead, the judge felt that Joseph was sorry that he got caught. The judge also stated that mental illness is not a defense that excludes criminal culpability, which I 100% agree with. 100%. Just because you have a mental health issue does not mean you have the right to go killing people. It does not exclude the fact that you are susceptible to criminal activity. Does not exclude that fact. Joseph was found guilty of 4 counts of murder, 2 counts of assault, kidnapping, rape, and attempted murder. Okay, so like I said, we were going to get back to that point where the judge said that he is not accepting the argument and that he does not believe that Joseph could not remember what he was doing. He could not remember these murders. So, like I said, Joseph had his psychiatrist slash psychologist to examine him, but the state also provided a psychiatrist, psychologist to examine Joseph as well. You know, let's cover all our bases. Now, according to Professor Gerard Labuschagne, sat down with Joseph. This professor is an expert on serial killers. He is a qualified psychologist. He has worked with over 100 serial killer cases. Just by that information, you can tell that he knows what he is doing. The professor did not detect or notice any abnormal behavior, which is very important because if you are as mentally ill or if you say that you are away, he should be able to pick up on those things that you say you are. Joseph would answer all questions. He would be willing to answer all questions except questions involving his case or the murders that were committed. All of a sudden, he would lose memory. The professor also confirmed that there's only one serial killer ever in South Africa who was declared unfit for trial. And that serial killer was definitely not Joseph. No connection was found between the crimes and his mental illness. Also a red flag. And it's safe to say that the professor agreed with the judge that the defense was using his mental health issues as the base, as the foundation for their argument, which did not make sense. I also came across another article which was very interesting because the manner in which these murders were committed. First of all, let's go through it a little bit and elaborate on why the judge would not agree with the defense. First of all, he would deliberately sort out these men that he selected. Now, usually, if a person is super unstable, you would expect them to kind of lash out at any person that would cross their path. Joseph would wait on the right opportunity to execute the murder. Okay, which does not speak of someone who is like ridiculously unstable, like a madman. You know what I mean? If he was as insane as he made himself out to be, or as his team made him out to be, then he probably would have attacked anybody in his path. But he waited for specific people and he made sure that those people were alone to attack them. Chose early hours of the morning where he knows that people are asleep and it's quiet and it will be easy to access that particular victim. Another thing that was noted about the way that Joseph killed was the fact that after each murder, he would keep his axe in a plastic bag. Okay, now to me, that makes me think that, okay, he does not want DNA, he does not want blood in his car, so he's smart enough to put that axe in a packet first before chucking it in the car. Also, when his home was raided, they found the bloody axe in an unused dog kennel. So he also made sure to not leave it inside his house because the number plate of the silver car that he was driving would be that one key that led them to his home. They raided his home 8 days later. Okay, and they found the murder weapon in the dog kennel. Another thing that was very interesting when it came to the analysis of this case is the force that you would need. The force that you would need to decapitate someone. Okay, first of all, this man is a big man. Let's not forget, he is a sportsman, or he was a sportsman. He was a rugby player. And yes, rugby players are big built in comparison to, let's say, soccer players. But as big built as they are, they still need to be able to run. So can you imagine being chased down by a large sportsman? Okay, so that was taken into consideration. And of course, the force, first of all, the bigness of the perpetrator, the force in which you would need to axe someone, to hack someone to death, and the decapitation itself would be tearing through skin, tissue, and muscle. And the neck is not particularly thin. It's not like a wrist, you know what I mean? So the force and the determination that he would have to make sure that a head is clean off the body, that would definitely be taken into consideration by the judge. Joseph was arrested on the 28th of March 2011. And the question still stands, what made him snap? What was it that tipped the scale? Like, and it's so scary to think of something like this, especially because with this case, like I said in the beginning, there were no droplets, there were no hints in his life, like in his upbringing, that would predict that he would turn out to kill so viciously one day, which is all the more scary, all the more sinister. Like, what happened? And of course, he played his card. He did not have any memory of the murders. But fortunately for the victims, justice prevailed and Joseph was sentenced to 5 life terms. So he is never getting out. 5 life terms.
Put simply, the killings were perpetrated in what can only be described as a brutally savage and barbaric manner.
That's how the court described Chongwane's killing spree 3 years ago. He drove around at night, targeting people walking alone. Chongwane overpowered his 4 male victims and hacked them to death with an axe. He decapitated 2 of them. The judge said the shock and horror the victims suffered must have been unimaginable. He said there were no compelling and substantial reasons for deviating from the prescribed sentence, because Chongwane was aware of his actions and the murders were premeditated.
The accused is sentenced to imprisonment for life.
And that is the Joseph Njongwana case. Please let me know what you think in the comment section. Did you know about this case? I didn't know about this case. I found out about it, pretty recently, and it definitely caught my eye. Very shocking. So let me know what you think in the comment section. Do you believe that it was because of his mental health issues that he snapped and that he suffered memory loss when it specifically came to questions about the case? Or do you agree with the judge and you don't believe it? It's just a tactic to, get him off the hook. Let me know what you think in the comment section. Did you enjoy this video? Give it a thumbs up if you did, and I will be back next Tuesday with another case. Otherwise, I will see you in my next video, which will be on Friday. It will be something more chilled and something more fun. So as I said, I'm trying to commit to True Crime Tuesdays, but we'll see how that goes. We'll see how that goes. And this video has kicked off a serial killer marathon. So, because serial killers are so fascinating, like ridiculous, they're ridiculous, but very fascinating. Anyway, guys, that is all from me. I'll see you in my next video.